Second Peter chapter 2, if you'd care to join me, please. I'm going to read, the last part of that chapter. It amazes me, for our regulars, you know, we've been talking about false teachers, false prophets, but also false teachers. And it amazes me how much God has to say on the subject. I mean, it just goes on and on and on, and God is never one who will ever be blamed for almost saying something. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, he's getting clearer and clearer.
That's right.
As we go along, and thank God for it, y'all. I don't want to almost know something.
That's right.
If it's good, I need it. And I want to know it. But anyway, 2 Peter 2:10. 2:10, obviously, we're cutting in the middle of something here. And by the way, y'all, the more I read on that thing, the more I thought, I'm going to have to preach either till Thursday or just pick out highlights here, because this is just good stuff and there's so much there. Anyway, verse 10, chiefly, but chiefly them that walk after the flesh, the lust of uncleanness, despise government, presumptuous are they, self-willed. They're not afraid to speak evil of dignities. Whereas angels, which are greater in power and might, bring not railing accusation against them before the Lord, but these, as natural brute beasts, made to be taken and destroyed, speak evil of the things that they understand not, and shall utterly perish in their own corruption, and shall receive the reward of unrighteousness, as they that count it pleasure to riot in the daytime. Spots they are, and blemishes, sporting themselves with their own deceivings, while they feast with... Can you imagine God calling somebody a spot or a blemish? That's what we got right here, y'all. Having eyes, verse 14, full of adultery, and that cannot cease from sin, beguiling unstable souls, and heart they have exercised with covetous practices, cursed children, which have forsaken the right way and are gone astray, following the way of Balaam the son of Beor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness but was rebuked for his iniquity. The dumb ass, speaking with man's voice, forbade the madness of the prophet. I'm going to stop the reading there. I was going all the way, but I ain't going to get this far. No way. Let's pray together, if you will. Now, Father, it's a blessing. It's a blessing untold to be able to gather here today in the Lord's house with the Lord's people, and then to open the Lord's book and to have the promise that the Spirit of truth will teach us all things and will guide us into all truth. I feel sure, Lord, every one of us in this room, we have tasted this truth. We have tasted your teaching us and guiding us. It's like the light bulb sometimes goes off. It's like the pieces of a puzzle all of a sudden fitting together. It's like understanding something for the first time, or maybe in a more deep way. I don't know how to describe it, but I know we've all tasted it.
Yes.
That's what we're asking for again today, Lord, that you give us more. I have nothing to offer anyone, but you're God the Almighty who gave us a book. We believe it from cover to cover.
Yes.
I don't understand most of it, but I still believe even what I don't understand.
Amen.
And that's only because of you. It's the gift of faith. Thank you for our faith. So, Lord, please now open our eyes that we may behold wondrous things from thy law. We pray it in Jesus' name, and all God's people said,
Amen.
Last time together. Oh, by the way, I've entitled the message this morning, Following Balaam. Following Balaam. That's a trick, right? Good. Not in this world. But anyway, last time together, we were in verse 9, focused on the fact that the Lord knows how to deliver the godly out of temptation. The Lord knows how to reserve the unjust.
Amen.
To the day of judgment to be punished. And we borrowed from these two statements The assurance that no matter how prevalent false teachers may become, and it's prophesied it's going to get worse as time goes along.
That's right.
No matter how much damage we may see the false teacher do, no matter how many souls the false teachers may in fact beguile, God has everything in control, and He knows how to deliver us from the foul influence of the false teacher, and He knows how to reserve them till Judgment Day when they get their just due. Philippians 4:6. I believe Miss Ann read this to us the other night. A clause. Someone help me here. Be careful for
nothing.
Absolutely. And that even includes the false teacher. We don't have to get all worked up about that thing. Are we to ignore them? No. Are we to listen to them? Certainly not. Are we to simply pretend that they're harmless? Absolutely not. But the rest of that verse, 4:6b, book of Philippians, in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. We pray that God will minimize their influence.
Amen.
We pray that God will expose the falseness of their teaching so that no one goes down the drain because of a false teacher.
Amen.
Gosh, in this world. Well, now in verse 10 down through the end of the chapter, which we won't get to, it's like Peter does a little more digging. Just to get us in a little deeper to this thing, we're looking at the personality of the false teachers. What kind of a person is the false teacher? What is the false teacher like if you watch him or her in their personal affairs, out of the spotlight? What's the character of the false teacher? Now, after reading part just verse 10 down through verse 16, I didn't even go through the end of the chapter. And it's rather pointed, y'all. But after reading even our part here, is there any doubt as to what God is saying about the false teacher? I mean, He makes it clear. You ever been to a restaurant and looked at an item they had offered, didn't know what it was? Anybody? And they show pictures. And we've been noticing this thing on TV. Now, speaking for me, I notice things that she don't notice, especially about food commercials. I like to eat, y'all. And I want it to taste good, and I want there to be a bunch of it. She says, well, you know, we can save money if we just go over here. I don't go out to dinner to save money. I go out to dinner to eat until I'm happy. And sometimes that takes a while. So they show a picture on TV. They show these pictures of lobster tails. They look like they're as long as my arm. And then they'll accidentally get some person's thumbnail in the picture, and they look like shrimp that's bait. You know what I'm talking about? And then there's shrimp. They'll have a bunch of them on a skewer. It looks like it's 36 inches long, and they get the end of a fork in there, and there's these four little bait shrimp on a toothpick. I want to know exactly what we're dealing with, and thank God it appears to me that's what we're looking at when we look in this passage, what God has to say. Why is it that God's so plain? Why is it He's so clear? Why does He go into such detail? To me, the obvious answer would be He wants us to recognize the false teacher when we see him.
Amen.
He wants us to recognize. Anybody here ever heard of a skunk? I was going to liken that to something. Every time I do that, I call out the wrong profession. I got to quit doing stuff like that. How about a skunk? You know, that's a souped-up cat with a racing stripe. Amen. You know what I'm talking about? Is there anything about a skunk that sticks in your mind, stands out? Their perfume. That is a smelling rascal when he wants to be. They tell me, well, if you get close to him, pick him up by the tail. And he can't spray you. You pick him up by the tail. I ain't going to do none of that mess. They ain't enough Mayor Juice in Dare County to clean me up. Gosh, distinctive. God wants us to know the false teacher when we look at it. So verses 10 through 14 give us a brief overview, if you will, of the personality traits of the false teacher, the things that we should be on the lookout for. I think there's about nine of them in total. Number one, they walk after the flesh. Now, you disciples know that when someone's walking in the flesh, in the church, this is supposed to stand out. Romans 8:8, they that are in the flesh cannot please God.
Amen.
Plain and simple. So what aspect of the flesh is it that they walk after? That's number two, the lust of uncleanness. Now, y'all, these are people standing with the Bible in their hand in front of God's people, telling them, this is what the Bible says. The second personality trait literally means the strong desire for things that are contaminated. The strong desire for things that we know are wrong, things that are not borderline, they're not marginal, things that, if you will, are so bad, they're contaminated, they look bad, they smell bad, everybody knows they're bad. The lust of uncleanness would include sexual sin. There is no reason for anyone with a Bible and who can read and who attends a Bible-believing church to know that there's nothing right about sexual anything unless it's in marriage.
Amen.
And then Katie barred a door. I mean, God did it, but outside of those confines, it's wrong. It's all wrong, completely wrong, will always be wrong, always has been wrong.
That's right.
You say, well, good night, why do you get so excited about that? Because that's wrong.
Amen.
And you ain't going to stand before God one day with a bunch of wrong all over you. You say, well, God, that's me. That's no problem. Just bring it to Christ.
Amen.
He said, do you believe that? You better believe that I believe that. Confess that sin. The Bible promises you that He'll forgive us that sin.
Amen.
And He'll cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Hallelujah.
Gosh. Y'all, the only bad thing about David and his amen, I may die right here in the pulpit. That thing just fires me up. To hear somebody that believes what I'm preaching, thank God for all of you Bible believers here. The lust of uncleanness. Number three, that comes as no surprise then when you remember number three, they despise government. Also could be translated lordship. They don't want to be told what to do by nobody, including Christ. That's their character trait. Number four, they're presumptuous. I had a hard time defining this, y'all. I had to dig a little bit deeper, but basically it means daring, not in a good way though, audacious, impudent, if you will, not the least bit hesitant to cross any line that anybody draws. That's what the word basically means there. Number five, self-willed. Literally, this one helped me. Self-pleasing. Self-pleasing. Number six, again, about the false teacher. Not afraid to speak evil of dignities. Now, this is a hard one for me. I always use the King James Bible. Folk have questioned me, why is that? My only reason is just one. Been saved right good while, started collecting resource books, reference books when I first got saved, 1973. And most of the works that I've, accumulated over the years are old. I've got two sets of commentaries, one of which was copyright 1812. That was back when I was a kid. Got another one edited in 1847. Back yonder, y'all, the only one they had, for the most part, was the King James Bible. So all of my reference works reference the King James. I'm not saying that others aren't just as good, but I am saying that's the one I like, because that's the one I've got all the dictionaries and commentaries and so on and so forth. But anyway, not afraid to speak evil of dignities. Didn't communicate a whole lot to me until I started looking around a little bit. The wording literally is blaspheming glorious things. Blaspheming glorious things does not bother the false teacher. And then we're given an example, and I'm inserting here, I hope it's not wrong, But in order to clarify what it is God's saying to us here, when the angels did not bring railing accusations, chapter and verse, someone suggested the book of Hezekiah. I ain't going to say another word. It's breaking my heart. The example comes from somewhere in the past, y'all, but we don't know when. To my knowledge, it's not specifically spelled out in the Bible exactly what's being talked about here in verse number 11. Now, some have suggested that what Peter is referencing here is the same thing we find detailed in the book of Jude. Now, we've already noticed there's a great deal of parallel between Jude and 2 Peter, both dealing with the same subject. Some of the same expressions are used. In fact, also Jude 8 and 9, likewise, Jude writes, speaking of the false teacher type, "These filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion," and here's our exact phrase, "speak evil of dignities." Now, Jude uses as his example what could very well be just a little more detail that Peter left out, but possibly the same exact example. Jude writes, "Yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he," the devil, "disputed about the body of Moses," Michael, "durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke thee." Now, all I know is, y'all, and I say this often, and you may think I'm trying to be funny. There ain't nothing funny about it. I'm not the sharpest tack in the box. I mean, I admit that. I really admit that. I'm thinking, what in the world has that got to do with a false teacher? Now, I'm going to tell you what I came up with it. If I came up with it, it's going to be foolishness. If it's the truth, it'll be from God and it'll bless your heart. But look here. First of all, the passage is dealing with Moses after he died. Okay? Question. Who here knows where Moses' grave is? And this is a trick question. What did you say, Carol? I hate it when Carol's right. I'm just teasing. Ain't nobody knows where it is. Say, well, how do you know that? Deuteronomy 34:6. God buried Moses. Do you believe that? You bet your bottom dollar I do. He buried him in a valley of Moab, quote, "but no man knoweth of his sepulcher unto this day." We don't know the details, but we do know the facts. And they're basically this. At Moses' death, the devil and Michael the archangel had an argument about Moses' body. What were they arguing about? I don't know. You ever been in a family where somebody's passed and they get together and try to disagree as much as possible about what to do since Dad just died? They're arguing about something. I don't know what's going on here. But to end the argument, Michael, at some point, the archangel, simply says to the devil, "The Lord rebuke thee." And the obvious implication is that was the end. End of the argument. All right, now that's our example, okay? Don't know anything but what we're told in this passage. But to understand what I'm going to call the reality of this thing blaspheming the glorious, you got to fix in your mind how this scene of the argument actually looked. Now think with me, if you will. The old preacher years ago said, you got to use your sanctified imagination. Everybody got one of them?
Amen.
Here we go. Somewhere in a valley in Moab, that's to the east side, of the Jordan River, overlooking the promised land, there stood, first of all, the devil. And we don't know a whole lot about him. Everything we know is bad. But he's an ex-angel. A used-to-be angel. If he had a name tag on his shirt, it was ripped off, and you could see holes where the threads were left. He was an ex-angel that had been thrown out of heaven. He'd been stripped of all of his glory. You get the impression reading in Ezekiel 28, Isaiah 14, that Satan, Lucifer, star of the morning, must have been, that's a speculation at best, but based on the wording, must have been of some rank in the heavenly hierarchy. But he's been stripped now of all of his glory, stripped of at least most of his ability and his power. It's possible that he was even a former superior of Michael, an archangel. But now, and these are my words, but I think they aptly describe, he's on a leash. And he's only able to do what God gives him permission to do. He thought he was going to show his stuff off in Job. And it only found out, he only found out later, all he could do was what God wanted him to do to start with. If he'd have said, Job, look here, or Satan rather, I want you to go down there and help Job grow in the faith, Satan probably would have said, I ain't going to do it unless you make me. So God just says, hey, I dare you to go down and get Job your best shot. Bring in the first string. Play overtime. Do whatever you want to do, Hoss. And what did he accomplish? Only what his leash allowed him.
That's right.
Just what God wanted. If you will, Satan, the devil, was on spiritual death row, headed toward the lake of fire forever and forever and forever. The expression in prison is dead man walking. The expression in heaven is ex-angel walking. Headed toward the doom. And then there's the other guy, Michael the archangel. Yes. The word literally means archangel, chief angel. Yes. Somebody says he's the chief. There's no indication of that to my knowledge in the Bible, but he's a chief angel and archangel at least. Now this much we know about him from between the lines. Now you got to think and you got to put these pieces firmly planted. Both sides of this argument, if you will. Now we've got Michael, faithful to God from eternity past. Oh, that's a long time. But he's never once stepped out of line. He's never once been unfaithful to his God and his master. Amen. Faithful. Probably receiving his rank of chief from past battles, past victories, past obedience to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords for all of eternity.
Amen.
He's never tasted defeat. He's used by Almighty God, evidently, only on very special assignments. And there he's been as a representative of the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. And he's empowered only by what the Bible calls the Lion of the tribe of Judah himself.
Amen.
But he has all of the resources of God the King at his disposal. He's simply God's messenger.
Amen.
So there, Michael, who with the 24 elders and the four beasts round the throne, and the 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of other angels, and all of the saints of all the ages who will rule and reign for all eternity, there stands Michael, the chief messenger of El Shaddai, Jehovah.
Hallelujah.
Now that's the two folks in an argument. Is it starting to come clear to you? When I got this far, I thought, good night, I can see something I ain't never seen before.
Yeah.
It's starting to get clear to me. You got the devil versus Michael, God's archangel, and they're arguing about the dead body of Moses. Now, I hope this don't make nobody mad. I know everybody's got their favorite TV people. Anybody here heard of John Wayne? How about this one? Anybody ever heard of Barney Fife? Anybody Barney? If you know Barney, raise your hand. You know, big strapping wrestler.
Right.
Flexes his pecs, pops buttons. Yeah, no, that ain't Barney. How about this one? You ever heard of Mike Tyson? Hey, if you can't beat him down, bite him. That's the one I'm talking. You got the picture now? Now, let me just borrow this. In the ring is Barney Fife and Mike Tyson. Now, Andy ain't there to referee. Barney always comes out on top, by the way, for any of you who will ever watch that spiritual program. But there they stand, y'all. Listen. If Barney Fife is in the ring with Mike Tyson, who do you think's going to win? Do you get my drift? You've got the devil, the ex-angel, booted out of heaven because he ain't worth nothing to God anymore.
Hallelujah.
And you've got God's chosen man over here who always wins, never loses, and has all of God's resources. Who do you think's going to win? But that's what we're looking at, y'all. That's who's in the ring. Would there be any chance at all that the devil could have won the argument?
No way.
Not a snowball's chance in you know where. It just ain't going to happen. And look, how about this? What weapon did Michael use to stop the fight?
The Lord.
A perfect display of not only who he is, but who he works for. All he said was, "Lord, rebuke me." Now, if I'd have been Michael, and thank God I'm not, I'd have said that grinning like a possum. You know, like, now what are you going to do, boss? I mean, seriously? I mean, Michael knew who he was. Michael knew whose he was. Michael knew who the devil used to be, but won't no more. And he simply says, "The Lord
will rebuke thee."
He said, "Well, reckon exactly what does that communicate?" Well, I ain't completely sure, obviously, other than when Jesus was walking the earth, giving us the life of God, the God-man here for us to look at, when he encountered a demon, all he had to say was, if by implication, you, I didn't mean you did, pointed the eyes over there, can't go too far though, she said, come out,
that's
right. Well, I ain't coming out. Did you ever hear that in the Bible?
No.
One time, book of Acts, these old boys, seven of them strong, decide they're going to cast out demons. And what is, y'all, wouldn't you like to have seen this one? If I'd have been there, I wouldn't have been grinning like the possum. I'd been jumping on the hollering. I'd be like the cheerleader she used to be. We command you to come out in the name of Jesus. These demons, similar to the false teachers, cocky rascals.
Yeah.
They basically said, "Who are you? We know about Jesus. We know about Paul. But who in the world are you?" You ever gone in to sit down at a meal somewhere and you sit down and the guy looks at you, "Who are you? What are you doing here?" And not only did the demons not come out, they jumped on the guys trying to cast them out, they whooped them, and then add insult to injury, they took all their clothes off. Now look, I ain't advocating nothing here, but do you understand what's going on? Not only did you get your hind parts whacked,
Right. They
stripped you down past your civvies and sent you walking out naked as a jaybird. Now, what do you think they felt about that? Anybody?
That's right.
I'm trying to say there was absolutely no contest there, but on the other side of that thing, when Jesus spoke to someone, no contest.
Hallelujah.
And all the angel had to do was borrow his name. No contest whatsoever, the Lord rebuked thee. Well, all of a sudden, I start getting a better picture. This is the example given us by God to help us better understand the false teacher and this business about his personality trait being presumptuous, self-willed, and not afraid to speak of glorious things. The false teacher, like Satan and like Barney, has chosen a no-win situation. They can't win. It's not up for grabs. It's when is the Super Bowl? Anybody?
Next Sunday.
Next Sunday. Come the gospel sing first. That may help you as you watch it. Anyway, that thing's up for grabs. This is not.
That's right.
No way in the world. Listen, the false teacher, the presumptuous self-will, not afraid to blaspheme glorious things, he, she is taking a stand against the eternal Word of God. That's really where the bear comes down the tree, though. It's not where an argument would know, well, I believe this and you believe that. Hey, that ain't got nothing to do with me or you, really. It's the Word of God. And I'm going to live and die and be gone. I told her she'll be the first woman that goes to her husband's funeral in a red dress wearing high-heeled shoes. It's okay to laugh. She does what I'm telling her. 24 hours, she probably won't remember my name. I'll end forever. Oh, and that's the problem here. The false teacher's dealing with the Word of God. He twists it. He turns it. He edits it. He gives folks options, alternatives, and choices that are simply not there. He, she is fighting against God in all of His infinite resources and has the church, who has all of God's goodness and His power at their disposal. There's no way a false teacher can ever win, make it through judgment, or be of any help to anybody who listens to him.
Amen.
And if that ain't enough, the list of the personality traits of the false teacher continues. Got to quit. 7, eyes full of adultery. Wonder what in the world that means. Duh. 8, they can't cease from sin. I thought to myself, wait a minute, I better offer a disclaimer here. That don't mean they're incapable. Today is, it ain't my fault. Yes, it is, dummy. I probably shouldn't say dummy, should I? Yes, it is. Ain't nothing my fault. Yeah, it's all your fault. This has to do with unwilling, not incapable.
Right.
I have the right to do as I bloomin' well please. That's what's being communicated here. Number nine, they regularly exercise with covetousness. If you will, their spiritual physique. Their I want your money muscles are well defined. God's told us, so we'll know what we're looking at. You ever see somebody with all the big muscles? And all the cuts in their, felt like Brother Bill. Every once in a while when I see him, I'll tell her that's no accident. They got them muscles by working on them. They practice. The false teachers in such practice of covetousness, when you look at them, they let everybody know, I love money, I got money, and I want yours. That's the bottom line, you poor old false teacher. Ain't no poor old nothing about that Bible twister. And y'all, if any of that don't move you, none of that helps clarify what we're talking about here, God gives us one more picture of the false teacher, and I promise I'll hurry through this thing. What the false teacher looks like to God, he, she looks like somebody who's following Balaam. You remember Balaam, right? Balaam, what a character. Balaam, what a man. Woo. What more would really need to be said? Balaam, anybody here ever heard the expression knucklehead? I ain't talking about a motorcycle. I'm talking about the Three Stooges. Knucklehead. What kind of a knucklehead would follow Balaam? I was in high school and worked at McDonald's. Where else would fat people work? Working in a hardware store, ain't nothing to eat in there. There was a manager of that particular store I worked in, I think it was like 16 or something, who had a mustache that looked just like Hitler. You know what I'm talking about, the little thing in the middle? Now, I wasn't a good student and didn't learn nothing, especially in government class. Civic. But who would want to look like Hitler. It made me mad just looking at it. I wanted to invite him to football practice. Chump. Who would follow Balaam, y'all? You remember Numbers 22 through 25. You read the account. It speaks so loudly and so clearly. A godless king hires Balaam to try and put a curse on God's people. Three little elements. Everyone in the country knew what God had already done for Israel, bringing them up out of Egypt. Everybody knew it. The girl at Jericho said, "Man, our hearts melted when we heard you turn down our road. This ain't going to be good." They'd heard it. They'd heard it. Listen, they heard what God had done for Israel since he brought them out of Egypt. It's been almost 38 years by this time. And now Israel's encamped in the plains of Moab. And there up on the hill stand Balaam and Balak the king looking down on Israel. Remember that? That's in there.
That's right.
Looking down. Now stop and think with me one last time. If I see smoke coming up, I'll know where it's coming from. Use your brain. Think about this. What Balaam and Balak saw. Israel numbered anywhere from 2 to 6 million people. That's more than will be at the Super Bowl and Walmart on Black Friday. You hear me? That's a great group of people. The procession alone, it's estimated, could have measured from 75 to 100 miles long. That's a pretty good parade, amen? When General Lee left Pennsylvania, I just had to say it. Coming back home, I won't bother pointing out he just got his hind parts spanked. There were some odd 25,000 plus Confederate soldiers still alive. Their procession, the wagon train for 25,000 Confederate soldiers, was 25 miles long. That's like from here to Wan Chis, y'all. And we're talking a few more people than that. The thing could have stretched out for 100 miles, and yet the Bible points out that Balak and Balaam saw them from up on the mountain. Hey, that's the people I want you to curse. And not only did Balak knew what God had done for the last 35 years. They also knew that every day of their journey, every time they marched, there was a pillar, not pillow, pillar, like a stone statue-shaped cloud that constantly moved in front of the procession.
Hallelujah.
Now, I'm used to driving vehicles that blow smoke out the back. This was a smoke cloud that didn't come from no oil burner out front. And it went ahead of the procession. You said, where'd that come from? The Bible. You believe that? Yes, I believe it. They saw that every time they looked down there at it.
Lord.
The thing had to be tall enough that 2 to 6 million people could see that thing. It had to be hundreds of feet high. And if that wasn't bad enough, every time they stopped at night, there was a pillar-shaped fire that rested over the tabernacle, lighting up the entire camp, and again high enough for all to see. This is what Balaam and this is what Balak were looking at, and these are the people that Balak wanted Balaam to curse. Well, can't you just see you stand? I can see Blake standing there right now scratching his chin. You want me to curse these guys? You have got to be blooming kidding me. I ain't got no pillar of fire. I ain't got no pillar of smoke. They got a great long list of miracles God's been doing them since most of them were in diapers, and you want me to try and come against this crowd? It ain't gonna happen. That would be what I would think. Now we got Mike Tyson down in the valley and Barney Fife up on the mountain thinking that he could win. Y'all, how could Balaam possibly think that he could outmaneuver God? How could Balaam possibly think that he could get the upper hand on God? How could anyone possibly think that he could possibly come out on top,
amen,
fighting against God,
amen,
against God's church and God's word?
Amen.
We've got the answer here. How would that happen? The wages of unrighteousness so blinded Balaam that he bit the bait and died for it.
Amen.
You say, what's that got to do with what we're talking about? The false teacher. The thought of being rich is blinding him to the fact. This ain't going to work. You're not going to get rich. If you do, you're not going to stay rich. And if you stay rich, you're going to wish you'd never had it. Because you've tasted, you've touched, and you've twisted the book of God.
Amen.
Gosh, you know, I'm getting the impression, you know, that God wants us to recognize the false teacher. I get the impression God wants the false teacher to recognize that he or she has become a false teacher. Unlike Balaam, can I close with this? You're here today and you're not sure about this whole Jesus thing. May I assure you, the Bible says this event has already taken place. He was seen standing at a door and knocking. People have painted a portrait of that thing. That door has no handle on it. And the picture being what's being communicated is Jesus wants to come into everyone's house and give you something you can't get nowhere else for no amount of money. But he cannot, he will not open that door. You must.
That's right.
You're here today, you don't understand what you're feeling. May I offer you a little input? What you're feeling is the knock of Almighty God by His Spirit in your inward man.
Hallelujah.
Calling you. You say, but I'm so sinful. So? You don't know what I've done. So? Hey, none of that matters. He's the Savior, not the condemner. He knows what you've done. He has it in His mind, and He's standing knocking today. Just wanting you to open the door and let Him come in. You'll never regret it. He says, He explains it this way. I'll come in, and I'll sit down, and I will sup with you. That's King James for sit down and have a meal with you. And you'll sit down and you'll sup with me. There'll be communion between you and God the Almighty. You can have it today. You can have Him today. You'll never want again what you've got if you'll come to Christ today. I promise you that. I never have. I never have. For 43 years, He's satisfied every longing in my soul. And everybody else hears the same way. So many. I'm going to ask you to come today. Let Him come in. That's all. Don't let anybody twist that thing out of your heart. Will you pray with me? God in heaven, how glorious You are. How wonderful You are that You would come to a sinner like me and the countless other sinners just like me down through the ages and just ask to come in. You're not going to take nothing. You're not going to rob anything. You want to come in and bring life everlasting.
Thank You, Lord.
Bring peace. Bring a calm, bring a quiet that's never been known before. It's real. Praise God for it.
Praise
You. We're asking You, Lord, in these closing moments to deal with every one of us in here where we are, as we are. It's something we need to bring to You. If we're the one who needs to ask You in today, God, please make us man enough. Please make us woman enough. Please make us humble enough. Come on.
Yes.
We pray it in Christ's name. I'm going to ask you to continue praying. Our group's going to sing. If God's laid something on your heart, now's the time. Won't you come? Won't you respond?